I mean, geez, there's so many. Jack.
That's just his name.
That's his first name. That's just his first name that his parents gave him.
Jack Wildermuth.
Yes.
You know him?
Yeah. Oh, I know him pretty well.
Know how to rev him up.
He's got a few nicknames around the place too. Pidgey.
Yeah, does he? Well, he's a walking nickname apparently. Yeah, so, Martin, run us through some of the ones he's got.
One of the, I mean, geez, there's so many. Jack.
That's just his name.
That's his first name. That's just his first name that his parents gave him.
Yeah, sorry.
You know, in hospital.
Another one.
Jackington.
Not a great start.
No, it's not.
I think it's the earphones.
You could have said any other name.
Yeah, his nickname, Jack. No,
to give you some context in the mistake I just made was...
Well, not your like, wife, Matt.
You don't have to explain yourself to us, mate. We're your friends.
When he runs in, we call him red or black.
Yep.
Red or black, because he nips it both ways. Yep. So which one is it today, red or black?
Mm-hmm.
Snake. Snowman.
I haven't heard that
snowman.
One.
Yeah, snowman. Snowman. We're fielding, and he was wearing one of the largest jumpers of all time. And occasionally, you know, being at square leg, it's a tough position to move laterally.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the ball gets going and, you know, beats him before he gets moving. So there's the nickname Snowman. Yeah, Snowman. He genuinely couldn't move in this big jumper. It was huge. Out opening the batting is Joe Burns and Marnus Labuschagne. Yeah.
What's the most wrong someone's got it? Mm. Like, people were very, very interested in that.
Well, I think the first name's the real kicker. When you get the first name wrong.
It's so phonetic, though. Like, yeah, it's quite simple.
I know. But I think it's also, you know, sometimes I get, you know, a couple of, you know, Instagram requests, right? People run in. And the amount of times, it must be autocorrect, right? Mm. Because the amount of times they write this, you know, really beautiful message, saying, oh, you know, can you help us out with something? Marcus. And you're like, geez, it just loses its sting. I really want to do this. But.
It's either autocorrect or they really wanted Marcus Harris. It's one of those two.
That's right. I mean, one of your nicknames, and this also was sent in a lot by listeners, was the loose bus change. That was one of the greats, I think, that when that sort of – because Nathan Lyon, I remember the interview where he said that and, like, people just shared it instantaneously. Mm. Like, it was just something that was the opposite to you having to work really hard.
Yeah.
That was just one that people were like,
that was on
genius.
The platter.
Yeah.
That's a genuine table. Get up and hit it out of the park. But I do feel like I could drop the three on LeBron. Yeah,
no, you don't. You can't drop a three on LeBron.
He's too.
You're not dropping that. No.
What if he doesn't get to you?
Yeah,
but that's what I mean.
He's going to stand like this and go away, you fly.
Yeah, but I would just get the, you know, the James Harden double step back, boom, and just drop it in.
You people are in fucking love, aren't you?
Yeah, so, I mean, one of my biggest beefs, right, is people's views on, you know, playing straight.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, look, important part of the game, I think it's a must, right? You have to be able to play straight. But, I mean, for the 2% of balls that land right at your feet that you get to hit down the ground, you have to beat the stumps, beat the bowler, beat mid off, beat mid on, and
the
then and beat the umpire who's moving left or right, and maybe you'll get four. It's just it's really overused. I feel like, you know, we grow up and everyone's like, oh, play straight.
Playing the V.
Where, I mean, I don't know if anyone's currently watching cricket, but Joe Root is not playing straight. He is playing through third man, runs it off the face four. I mean, I would like to see it. Yeah, third man would be a nice position. Yeah, I don't know if we can make sure we drop one back. I think it's definitely one we're looking at for the Ashes.
The Ashes.
But I think that's one of my biggest beefs. That and, I mean, the old classic, watch the ball.
Oh,
well, what do you think I'm doing out here? Yeah, you think I'm watching the moon? Like, you know, watching the ball, play straight. And probably the other one is just, you know, you just got to move your feet. You got to move your feet. That's a big one. Yeah, move your feet to get your pad ripped off.
Yeah.
But a good point on that, right? Well, I definitely think that there's times where, you know, when you're playing, you just see the ball really good, right? If it's because the sun's going a certain way or, you know, the bowler's got a nice action and you just get a really good sight. And I don't think that's why it's hard in cricket, right? Because I don't think that's a replicable. Is that
right?
You know, a thing to replicate. I think it's really hard to see like that every game. So if you can only score runs on the day that you see them like that, you know, you're going to be quite small margin. I mean, I've only had that in probably one innings in my test career so far where I just felt like I saw the ball so early, you know, the seam. I just felt like, you know, you almost get that instinct where you almost feel like you know where the bowler's going to put it.
The ball slows down a little
bit. Yeah, 100%. And that was at Headingley.
Mm. Yeah, I was going to say, talk us through that innings, man.
And that was exactly it, right? Headingley, I just felt like, you know, I got in, I felt like it was really dark and gloomy, but sometimes when it's dark and gloomy, it's actually can be easier to see the ball.
Mm.
You know, people say a lot of the time it's actually harder to bat, but it's easier to, from a visual perspective, because you don't have the sun from obviously coming from the opposite ends shining on the ball. So it can be easier to see the seam.
Mm.
And that day specifically, I just remember kind of what you just said, Goads, just the ball slowing down. Mm. And I felt like I almost knew where they were bowling. I knew when I could leave, and I knew when I could, when I could attack. Mm. And I've always sort of thought, geez, how can I get that back? And how can I have another innings like that? But I think the more and more I've played, I've just learned that, that doesn't happen. You need certain situations to really make that happen. If it's, a series or, a bowler like, Jofra or someone where the ball is nipping a lot and all of a sudden, your senses just go up a level.
Mm.
But interestingly, to back that point, Martin, you didn't get 100 in that Headingley test, and you've got multiple hundreds since. And so you're saying that you actually haven't seen the ball as good as that day, but you've still managed to rack hundreds left, right and centre.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, if people ask me what's my best test innings, I would say first innings I played at Headingley was the best innings I felt like I played in terms of, everything coming together, decision-making, playing and leaving, good bat path, just all those small things come together.
Really clean,
spot on. And I just felt like I just couldn't, you kind of get that sense like they can't get me out, it's going to take something. And you know what? It took a full toss, a full bugger from Ben Stokes to put me on my face. But it was that sort of delivery that would actually snap you out of that because you were so, watching the ball in the hand onto the pitch. And I think sort of to your point there about the hundreds, I think you're still watching the ball, right? But you just don't see it as well sometimes. But I think you can't combine the two. You can't say, well, I've got to see the ball really well to score runs, right? You still got to watch the ball. And there's still cues I use to try and get myself to focus more on the ball.
Yeah, for sure. Does your first 100 then become your favorite 100, do you think, Mark?
First one.
So it's your special, I guess.
Yeah, the first one's the favorite for so many reasons because I think you're nervous because you've never got there, right? And I think I was up to 5 test 50s by that, obviously, in the current one as well. Mm. I was 5 test 50s and it was sort of hanging over me, right? Can he convert those, starts that he got in the Ashes? Can he actually convert those into hundreds?
Mm.
And that was something that as a young player I struggled with, right? I didn't get many big hundreds as a kid or even, going into first class cricket. 2 years ago, my highest score in domestic cricket was 130.
Mm.
So I think that's the sort of that part of it makes the first one good because you never know if you can get there, right? Mm. Until you actually get there. And I think once you actually get the first one, it relaxes you and you actually know how to get through those, nervous 90s or those nervous moments.
Mm.
And I remember because I actually was given out LB on 92, I reckon, off Yasser Shah. And I reviewed it obviously straight away.
That's surprising.
Surprising that I reviewed one and got one right. Yeah, me too. So I think even those sort of things sort of bring you back, obviously reviewing it going righto. Because I felt like I was being a bit reckless at that stage. I was like, just taking it on because, you know, when you sort of only played a few games, you just play with freedom, right? You're like, I'll get there. But you can't really put a number on how important it is to get over the line for that first time.
Well, and probably the fact that you want to get there, you just like, fuck it, I want to get there quick.
Yeah.
3 hits, let's go. Bang, bang, bang. Let's see if we can do it.
Yeah, and I've done that quite a lot in probably the last few years when I get to 100, gone from, let's say, 92 to 100 in, 3-4 balls. I did it in the test. And I think that's just sometimes you get a read on a bowler, right? Yeah, yeah. You just get that feeling, right? If he bowls us there, you know, I'm going. But yeah, I think that's where the importance is just, you know, I've only gotten, how many times have I gotten out in the 90s? Probably three times in the last few years I got out in the 90s.
Your name has been thrown up as a potential leader. Is that something that you have ambitions to do? Captaincy in general, I guess, but particularly captaining Australia. Is that how do you sort of, I know it's a hard, difficult one to answer. You're not going to go, yeah, I'm ready to take over tomorrow. But is it something that you like just enjoy in terms of the way you play your cricket? You like thinking about the game? Is it something that you could see yourself doing?
Look, I don't know too many people that are ever going to get asked to be the Australian captain and go, no, thanks, mate. I'll take a rain check.
Gonna focus on fielding.
Yeah, I just got to work on my short leg. If there's ever a way to get out of short leg, it's probably getting the captaincy. To be fair, Punter was on the other side, and without a helmet as well.
And he was a guru.
And he was gone.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to the point, I think – as captaincy is not something I think you can search for. I think it's something that sort of comes to you, right? So obviously everyone can see, you know, the writing on the wall. You know, obviously Tim has been doing a fantastic job for the last three, four years. And whoever they go with after that, you know, who knows, right? There's a few candidates. Obviously Pat Cummins is one of them. And whoever it is going to do a fantastic job. And regardless if that person is you or someone else, I mean, it's about supporting the team, right? It's about what you can bring to the team to help us win games, right? If that's from a tactical point of view or from small things, leadership things that you can do on and off the field. But I definitely love thinking about the game. I love, you know, sort of when you're out in the field, thinking like a captain. I think we all do it, right? What would I do in this situation? What would I do? So, yeah, I definitely think it's something that that I enjoy and would enjoy, but I don't think it's ever something that you can want too much, because I think that's when you know, it can be in the wrong hands.
Have you been involved in more runouts in cricket than the average cricketer, would you say?
No.
Ooh, that hurts on a personal level.
Okay. Scan away there, mate. Just hand down. And it doesn't say scanning, which is disappointing.
That hurts.
Just, just maybe replace it on there. Oh, here we go. Oh, error. Excellent. It was that bad.
No, this is going good.
Oh, here we go. We're on.
Perfect. Oh, we should have really got the upgrade.
You got the light version.
It says scanning.
You got a big hand, though. So you can remove now. It looks like that's a lie.
Oh, I feel like this is a stitch up, boys, because I know what the next question's going to be for some reason.
I know this thing definitely works. I've tried it on me before. Did you copy all of your batting mannerisms from Steve Smith?
No.
No. Okay. Interesting. Yeah,
interesting where you're placing that hand before you pass it.
I'm just pressing scan. Yeah, let's scan. Yep, that's scanning. Jeez, it's getting better as it goes on in this segment.
Just warming up.
Couple of run throughs. Yeah. What do we got there? Still scanning. Jeez,
that is red.
It's a lie. Yeah. I knew it.